And Fishlock spots the keeper off her line. Jeff Fishlock has superior talent to just about everyone else in world football, and she showcased it there. Melbourne City strike first in the grand final.
Recycled by Kisnorbo, back in by Dugansic, and there's Corkaloo to win the derby for City!
Hello everybody, and welcome to the Talking City podcast, COVID-19 edition. We are recording across state lines. My name is Matty. I'm joined by Angus from Sydney, also known as BT from Ballarat. How are you going, Angus?
Very good, mate. How are you?
Oh, I'm not too bad, mate. I'm not too bad at all. We've also got the real BT from Ballarat. Hello, BT.
I'm Angus from Sydney.
I'm Angus from Sydney, actually. I think you'll find.
We're all Angus from Sydney.
We're all Angus. And I've also got Lachlan White, Dr. Lockie, as it were, down in the bottom corner.
Oh, bringing a friend with me, of course, from years gone by.
Two Maddies are better than one. That's what I always say.
Two Maddies, two BTs.
Two Maddies. Where is BT in that photo, actually?
I don't know. I'd imagine
based on having a look at it before and where Tomo is, I'd imagine that me and BT are probably exactly behind where Lockie's sitting at the moment. Yeah. And we'd be banging behind Lockie's chair.
Get you to roadmap the old terrace. All right, yeah. Guys. How are we all holding up during this isolation period? It's a strange
Saving
time.
Saving a lot of money. So, not a lot else. I played a lot of Football Manager, man. Lost.
So much football.
It's damaging manager. To my relationship, to the point where my fiance started calling it my mistress. But you know what? This is my chance. This is my chance to shine. And you don't get opportunities like this to play this much games. No, so right. I'm taking that opportunity while I can.
Have you been suiting up for the games, Gussie?
So in my first season, I took Chelsea to the Champions League final against Manchester City, and I didn't suit up and I lost on penalties, and I completely think it's because I didn't suit up. Yes. So next time I make a Champions League final, I will be suiting up. So I've played three full seasons so far, though. So I'm aiming for 10 seasons of this save, and then I'll take it from there.
Gus doesn't seem like the kind of guy who'd be going into games just wearing, you know, shorts so he could run around and train with the players in the warm-up.
No, I'm a big advocate for the manager wearing a suit. I think the manager should always be suited. Yeah. The one thing I would say about...
Is this why you hated Warren Joyce, not a shorts man?
I liked the novelty of the shorts at first, and then I started hating him when I realised he was a shit manager. So I was like, you know, that's why I didn't really like Joyce. But I like Monbez. I like the glasses as well. But I always thought Babbel was good. Just like, he's a terrible coach. Didn't do anything.
Good dresser.
But he was dressed nicely. So, I don't know.
Brent Straka was the OG dress crazy gangster coach.
You've got to have some respect, though, for the Arsene Wenger / Sir Alex Ferguson, like the long puffer jackets as well.
That they those can't were, operate.
Yeah. Oh, those things were classic. So that's like the iconic look of the Premier League.
Yeah.
And, a golden era of the time.
I'll tell you what, one of my mates bought one of those old Nike puffer jackets that Wenger used to struggle with, and the zippers were absolutely fucked. Like, that was a very bad advertisement for those jackets. But I've been playing a bit of Football Manager too, Angus. Funnily enough, speaking of Warren Joyce, he is my under-23's assistant manager at Sunderland. He has a man management rating of 4, which I think is very accurate.
Yeah, it's a bit high, don't you think?
Right? Yeah, actually, you're probably right. And that's out of 20 for BT, by the way. BT doesn't play Football Manager.
Can I ask why you hired him after what we've been through?
He just has really good defense and tactical stats for training. So I was like, fuck it. I'll just chuck him in the under-23s and have him train the kids.
Okay.
Yeah. I don't have any sort of... I've also got Paul Scholes as a coach, mate. So I don't really hire people based on the quality of their character.
Fair enough.
But we should be calling Netflix at this point because 108 points in the first season went straight up. So I don't see why it's that hard. We'll make a fucking documentary about that. So let's get into the good stuff. I had this up on my other laptop. I'll open the article again, but the Hyundai A-League the other day pretty much confirmed that as everything that we knew was going to happen, right? That the postponement is continuing indefinitely at this point. Do you guys feel like there's any hope at all that the season gets resumed? Because for me, this is just a matter of time, in my opinion. I don't think the A-League is going to come back. I don't think they're going to finish this season. I think at some point there's going to be like an inevitable cancellation or voiding of the season. What do you guys think?
I think we will probably finish the season for the simple reason that from a coronavirus perspective, we are doing better than the vast majority of the world in terms of being able to get things under control and just not be an out of chaos mess. I mean, you have a look at the fact that I made predictions months ago that we would have been at 9,000 cases by the end of March, and we're not even at 9,000 cases now. We're down to probably about 1,200 active cases across the entirety of the country.
You were scaremongering hard, mate. You were just.
I wouldn't say it's scaremongering. I'd say
he was terrifying the fuck out of me and Troy.
If Troy has stopped smoking because of me giving him accurate representations of what has been going on everywhere in the world, then that's not a terrible outcome. But the fact that it's
small man.
Yeah. I saw an article saying that nicotine could help prevent coronavirus. So I hope Troy didn't
say
that.
Yeah, they're using nicotine patches in Europe.
I think in a lot of parts of Europe they're using whatever they can, except maybe bleach, because that's retarded.
Are you meant to inject sanitizer now? That's what I've been doing.
God Almighty! interestingly, one of my friends' brothers is living in New York and had coronavirus. So hearing about it, secondhand for what it's actually like, it's not something that you want to ever have to deal with. It's pretty horrendous. So the fact that we've got so far, touch wood, away with less cases and less, hospitalizations and less deaths than the rest of the world is promising. But, I think what it tells me is that if things continue on the path that they're going, I do see a point in time in the future where we can at least go back to playing and finishing this season, I think is one of the key things. It's obvious Sydney's going to win. The only thing that comes out of this season now is who gets the places for Asia, because nothing else really counts towards anything. But I feel like they probably will start moving towards there. And I suspect, similar to the EPL, we'll be looking at early June for a start.
Well, what we've got, which works in our advantage, is that we've got probably the longest off season in world football. And I know we whinge about it all the time, but it's probably going to work in our favour.
Yeah,
the other thing is that we've only got three games to go for City. Like, obviously, Wellington and Victory have a stack of games that they've got to make up. But we've only got Adelaide, Western United and Sydney to play.
Sydney, which we would have been playing today as well.
Yeah, well, it's not a lot of football to make up for us. Whether we go for the Party Island approach that the NRL seems to be thinking. But the NRL have said they're coming back on the 28th of May.
The NRL have no choice. They'll be absolutely fucking
I don't think we've got much choice either, to be honest. But if the NRL is confident that they can come back, I don't see any reason why the A-League can't play three games. People are going to be bursting at the seams to just get any kind of live support going as well. So I think that there's community support for the idea as well. Look, I'm 50-50. We may not. I don't know. But I'd like to see it come back, and I don't think that there's a lot of football to be played. So scrap the final series, just play for the plate.
So if it were to come back, and I'll throw this one to BT first because he's been quiet so far. If it were to come back, do you feel like they'd go with a hub approach, which is the sort of thing which the AFL, I guess, have been suggesting, constantly the last couple of weeks? Or do you feel like they try to wait until they're in a position where they can potentially have them at stadiums?
I think it probably depends on the timing of when we go back. Obviously, the reason behind a hub approach is that commercial flights might not be going as normal. So if commercial flights are back, then perhaps you don't need to do that. I think the reality will be that they'll probably have to do something like that. Everyone will base in Sydney or something like that and play between Newcastle, Central Coast and two Sydney grounds. I think we can forget about having crowds, at least, if not for this season, probably the entire calendar year.
I don't think there'll be crowds either way till 2021.
I think probably the other thing to consider is the fact that we do also have Wellington that we have to deal with. So when they come over, they're still going to go through the two-week isolation period of time, government mandated.
I've got the inside scoop on that one is that Warriors have received clearance. Yeah, so the Warriors have received clearance to avoid doing that for the NRL. I dare say a similar arrangement would be set up with Phoenix. So exceptions are possible if you can, there's like a variety of tick boxes, but basically I've heard that the Warriors have been given the all clear from the NRL. And so the similar thing will probably be happening with the Phoenix. So I wouldn't be too concerned about that. I got that from a Rugby Australia point of view as well. So, because they're dealing with a similar issue with Super Rugby and with Bledisloe and those kind of things. So there's definitely exceptions in place for supporting teams that could come between New Zealand and Australia.
I think the big thing that may change everything is if there is that second wave, which is always a possibility. We saw it happen in Singapore. Singapore had something like 190 cases for an extended period of time. We were relatively under control. And then in the space of about 2 or 3 weeks, they jumped up to 10,000. So it can very rapidly change. This is a very aggressive disease. So the situation changes on a day-by-day basis. And it's good that we're holding firm at the moment and doing pretty well, but it is something that, you know, we can start to relax things and things could change. We know that Queensland is starting to wind back their restrictions as of May the 2nd. So we could start to see things change shortly after that.
The interesting thing is as well, is if we are going for a hub approach, Sydney is the worst hit part of the country. So there's significantly more cases, there's significantly more community outbreak in Sydney. So possibly you'd have to consider whether Sydney's the right place to do it.
I suggest that.
Personally, Sydney's not the right place for anything, to be totally honest with you.
They pay a lot. When you've got four of the teams there, I see that it makes like some kind of sense there. I personally would probably be looking strongly at an Adelaide or Perth if they can take those the capacity there, just for the simple reason that it's just lower cases.
And I mean, Hindmarsh Stadium's a good ground for playing football.
It's a
as
ripper
well.
Ground. The one thing you'd be concerned about is whether or not it could handle that volume of games, or at least in Sydney or in Melbourne, you could kind of spread it out between a few different stadiums.
Yeah, that's true.
I suppose if it's behind closed doors, though, you know, you've got some pretty good NPL clubs in Adelaide. Like, you know, you've got Adelaide City, you've got very decent facilities.
Well, that's the thing. They don't need to be played at A-League standard grounds because there's no concern about,
crowds. Requisite, though, in the A-League rules. I'm fairly sure about the quality of the grounds, though.
Like the quality of the turf and whatever else, but in terms of
do the NPL teams make that? Yeah, well, spot on. You could play it in the suburban park for all anyone cared, but as far as it comes to crowds, but I think there's like the quality of the actual turf and the size of the grounds and those kind of things that need to be thought of.
I wonder how many NPL grounds actually have like the standard turf or good enough quality turf for that to take place. Because obviously you see a few of them take part in the FFA Cup. So there's got to be some that I guess do, but it's a different competition.
A lot of the Melbourne and Sydney ones would. Like I went to Marconi to go watch the women play and that turf was absolutely fantastic. So, you know, there was definitely some of the suburban grounds and you obviously been to Lakeside Stadium and Knight Stadium in Melbourne.
Ballarat's that standard, so surely there'd be a fair few Melbourne.
Yeah. Is it Moorhead? Moorhead? Moorhead. Yeah, that's a pretty good one. So there'd have to be a few out there.
Rent-limiting step would be whether they've actually been upkept to the same degree that they would have previously in this period of time. Because if they're not being used, then, you know, to pay for maintenance and upkeep is...
That's a good point.
Maybe something that some grounds wouldn't be doing if they're not professional sporting grounds, but... Who knows?
Yeah.
So can we go around the circle and just get a yes or no answer to everyone if we reckon the season's going to come back?
No.
Yes.
I'm a yes as well. So three yeses and a no.
Fair enough. All right. So with having that discussion, one thing we did sort of float before the podcast is that if the season was to end, which it sounds like I'm the only one that thinks it would, so you know that's a minority view anyway, but if it was over today, from a squad standpoint, if we can maybe have a bit of a chat about how the squad's set up and what we could potentially be looking to do for next season. Before we delve too deep
into that, Matty?
RoboCop. Yeah, this Matty made more sense than Robot Matty did at that point in time.
he always does. So should I go for the whole point again?
That you're asking was to do with what are we going to do with the squad at the end of the season if it does just stop today?
Yes. But before we launch straight into it, do you think that the that this current situation is going to have an impact on squad numbers, on things like salary caps? Are we going to see a flow-on effect from the issues of COVID-19 that maybe changes how that's structured in the next season and seasons beyond?
I certainly think that there will be. I mean, the PFA's come out and said that they want to make sure that all contracts that are ending May 31st, which is for us seven senior players, will be continued until the season is completed. There have been rumours in the media that the clubs who are the owners are talking about decreasing the salary cap by 40% to compensate for the potential losses, which is a pretty significant thing to ask, because people who've got professional contracts, I'm not sure you can just say to them, hey, cool, we're going to drop your pay by 40%. You don't get a say in it. I think there'd be a lot of questions raised by this, the PFA if that were the case. But I think clubs are certainly considering how they're going to survive in the long term from this. And, you know, a 2.7 or whatever million dollar salary cap per season, if they don't have money from Fox Sports, which is another thing to consider, it is going to be a very difficult thing to pay, particularly when they're not going to get the same amount of income coming in from ticket sales, from merchandise. So there'll be some things. In terms of our off-contract players, there was an article we published a couple of months ago that basically told us seven players are off contract. Dean Bizanis, Denny Jeanreau, Lachlan Wales, Harrison Delbridge, Roston Griffiths, Nat Kinson, and Florin Berenguer. So one of those seven is a Visa marquee, and the rest are sort of there or thereabouts with the first 11. So it'd be interesting to see what happens to some of those players.
Do you want to go through each of them and analyse the case for keeping them on?
Yeah, we definitely can. I mean, we can also talk about, I guess, just to touch on what you went through just then in terms of salaries and reduction to caps and things. I know it's a different standard of competition in terms of where their standings are in world sport, but the NBL, I think it was about a week or two ago, concluded negotiations with players where there were some pretty significant agreed payment cuts across the whole league. You're looking at like to the degree of, I think, 25 to 30% in some cases, even to players who were approaching minimum salary contracts. So it will be interesting as to how that goes, because on one hand, as you say, players aren't going to be keen, and the PFA is not going to be keen on wholesale cuts. But if there's no league to play in, nobody's making any money anyway, right? So there might have to be some movement there. We've even seen some overseas with EPL clubs. I think Arsenal agreed a 12.5% cut with most of their players. I think Chelsea are in the process of a similar outcome.
Yeah, Chelsea have agreed about 10%.
Yeah, so there's you would think there's probably going to have to be some sort of movement from that standpoint, because, you know, however, whatever happens in terms of a return to football, the finances aren't going to start out in the same position. There's just no way. So,
curiosity, what is the average wage in the NBL?
I don't know what the average wage is, but I think their minimum is in the 50s. I think their minimum's about 56, 57. And their top tier guys, I think, are probably somewhere like in the high 200s, I think. So it's not a very high paying league. So 25, like a 25% pay cut for some of those guys is probably substantial. That being said, they also have a short season. I think it only maybe goes for like 4 or 5 months. So they probably have jobs in the off season as well. But from a standpoint of percentages, there's a lot of money being given up there in a professional league. So it will be interesting to see how the A-League and the players and the PFA, if they have any sort of negotiations that are similar.
Because I think the average, the minimum wage in the A-League is, I think, 66,000 or something for youth players. And the average wage is about 150,000. So it's not exactly small when you consider that it's not an incentivized contract. It's not based off bonuses. It's just a flat fee. That's it. So they're, you know, the wages have been steadily increasing as the salary cap's been increasing in terms of the percentages bit by bit by bit. So it's hard. A lot of the players are on very short-term contracts, and we know that the life of a sports person means that you're only got a short period of time to make the vast majority of money that you will for your career. So it's difficult, but yeah.
All right, so I guess we can go onto the squad then and have a bit of a look at the players we've got there and go by one by one and what we would do. As you said, Lockie, there was an article. I think you wrote the article that
was
up a couple of months ago. Oof, you got some spicy replies for that one. That was good fun.
That was great.
Let's kick off those spicy replies again, because I'm sure there'll be a few. And we'll go through the names.
Shall we go with the spiciest first, or shall we leave the spiciest to last?
What do you want to do? That you go spicy through slice? In go from the back to the front, I would surely say.
Okay. All right. So in that case, there'll be a very spicy one at the start and a very spicy one at the end. So let's kick off with going back to front, the spiciest of all, Dean Bouzanis. I would keep Dean Bouzanis. I don't think he's had a very good season. I think, contrary to popular opinion, Dean Bouzanis actually had a pretty decent season before he went overseas for that loan to Holland. Since he's come back, he's looked probably about half the keeper he was. But I still think that when you take into account the fact that we'd be getting a discount or close to getting a discount on him due to long service, and the fact that he wouldn't be on much money to start with, I don't think you're going to find that many better backup goalkeepers in the league, especially when you're in the scenario that we're in, where your number one keeper is, what, a 19, 20-year-old guy who can't be on an obscene amount of cash either. I'd keep him.
I completely agree. And I think we spoke about it on the SEN podcast once, which was that we think he's probably on somewhere about $125,000-$150,000 a season. But of that, 25% of it from next year onwards will be outside of the cap. So what you're talking about is a goalkeeper of Dean's quality who's only on about $100,000 within the cap, which gives you that capacity to spend money elsewhere where you might need it for attackers, defenders, midfielders, wherever we're going to need to strengthen for next season. In terms of Aussie keepers who are off contract, because we don't want to talk about putting another visa player in there as a goalkeeper, because unless you're getting someone like Tommy Sorensen's quality, which you'd have to spend far more than $100,000 for, the only options really are Australians. So you've got Brad Jones, who's coming off contract, who's 34. Lawrence Thomas, who's a victory player, so let's rule him out. Matt Acton, victory player, rule him out. Adam Federici, he's 35, plays for Reading.
That's a lot of money.
So that's a lot of money for, you know, those players so far. Luis Italiano, who's been inconsistent and barely played, and he's 29. So he's got the same amount of age as Dean Bouzanis, but probably less experience. Tando Valapi, who's 33 now. Great player. Love him.
Bring him back.
He's also had very little actual time on the pitch when you consider what his career has been. For someone who's 33, he's not had a great deal of experience. It was primarily the time with Hart, and other than that, he's been sitting on the bench for the entirety of his career. So difficult. And then Nick Suman, who's a 20-year-old from Western Sydney, which would mean you've got two 20-year-old goalkeepers as you're starting in your backup goalkeeper, which I think is probably not a safe decision to be making. So I don't think there's anyone better than Dean Bouzanis who's available. So I'd strongly be, you know, giving him another multi-year deal.
I think the whole idea with Dean's spot, it really comes back to, do you think Glover's the man for the job for next season? If it is, then I don't see why you would go waste any money on a second goalkeeper when Dean's clearly got experience at the level, has been okay in patches. It's just a waste of money to go for anything else if you see Glover as the second keeper, as the first keeper. If you see him as the second keeper, well, then maybe it's a different story. But again, you're going to have to go and spend money on a position, and how much you're going to get benefit-wise that you could otherwise get in a different part of the pitch.
Yeah. Yeah, I agree with that.
Nothing more to add. It's honestly, it's going to come down to, like BT says, is Glover our number one keeper? If he is, yep, keep Dean. If he's not, Dean goes. And then Glover can sit on the bench behind whomever they decide is going to be the number one. I don't think that the quality's in there. Like, Jones seems like he's mentally checked out a while ago. Federici probably would be coming for kind of a swan song, and I just don't really want to see that.
I just can't see Federici wanting decent money. I mean, I think he's at Stoke at the moment in the Championship. That's a recently relegated Premier League club. The guy's going to be on good cash.
Mm.
So there's, I mean, if he's on something like £10,000 to £20,000 a week, how the hell are you going to afford a guy down here in the A League playing in goal for comparative money? Because if you can't offer him comparative money, what motivations do you have to come back?
Is he from Melbourne? Is what I'm just checking now is the other thing. So yeah, he's at Stoke. He's from Nowra. Yeah, he's from the South Coast. He's from Sydney. So.
Yeah,
I don't see any incentive for him.
Like, I have no doubt he'd be just about the best keeper in the league, but he's just too much money. And I think if you do, to touch on what BT said, if you do think Glover's your number one keeper, get some games into him. Get, you know, like, he can only improve and develop, you would assume, at the age he's at. So if you feel like he's your goalkeeper for now and therefore your keeper for the future, why push him behind?
And to be a bit cynical and put your accountant's hat on for a minute, the club would be mental not to keep Glover and potentially look to cash in the next 18 months.
I agree. Yeah. Okay, so who's the next on our list position-wise, Lockie?
So there's a big, tall, lumbering centre-back that may be a big player that Angus
Hall likes.
Big, tall, potential liability who's got three red cards this year. Harrison Delbridge.
Two of which were totally undeserved.
I keep him.
Yeah, I think we can almost tie this into two in one go to a degree. Harrison Delbridge and Roston Griffiths. And we talked about this offline maybe last week, Angus and BT. I reckon that for next season, I would be having... I mean, I know you've got the big Austrian sitting in there as well who's been the victim of numerous injuries. But I think that Curtis Good, Harrison Delbridge... or Curtis Good, Roston Griffiths and Harrison Delbridge is a really good trio of centre-halves.
Yeah, agreed. I think that Delbridge stays... having Griffiths there for a bit of competition is going to be good for him.
Mm-hmm.
Griffiths is going to reinvent himself, I think, and get another 2 or 3 years as a centre-back in this league. And, yeah, I would keep both of them.
Yeah.
The other thing is with Delbridge is Delbridge has actually been here for a while now. Mm-hmm. And losing players has been a systemic issue of our club since the start. And if we're just going to continue to ship players out when they've got tenure, it's going to continue to be an issue. And I think having Harrison around the club is going to be a good thing for us. So I'd keep him as well, just on that basis.
I think when you've got good characters, you should, if they're good enough to play at least some part of your squad, you should keep them around. We want to try to build a bit of a culture here. And the continuous rotation of players, I don't think, is particularly helpful. BT?
Yeah, look, I don't think any of them are on mega bucks. So if they're all on a reasonable thing that's not taking too much out of the salary cap, That's a great first three, and it allows you to use your visa spots on positions that perhaps Australians are not particularly wealthy in, and that's in the front third. And that, let's be honest, that's probably been, well, our wingers have probably been our bigger issue this year, and maybe a 10. So,
yeah, I mean, you could potentially be in a position, and we'll get to another player in the back four shortly, but you could potentially be in a position where your entire back five is filled with Australians. And, you know, that's not something that many other clubs in this league manage to do with any great success. And I feel like we've got a number of players there that could do that successfully. And that then opens up so many options for you from a visa standpoint in the front half of the pitch. You've got, what, 5 visas to use on that entire area. And that would, assuming you didn't have Winbickler, which I think he's contracted for next year. So that's probably not.
Yeah, I'd look at releasing him, to be fair.
Yeah, so you think he'd accept it though? I mean, in the current climate, if you were him, why would you go anywhere?
Yeah, look, it's a good thing to consider. I mean, I personally would release Winbickler.
I would.
I think the only thing to consider with Griffiths is the fact that he's rumored to be on reasonable enough coin, and whether or not you would need to maintain that, or whether you'd be able to drop his coin back a little bit, because I suspect Delbridge is going to be warranting a pay rise compared to what he was on when he first came. Because when he first came, he was playing in the NASL with
FC Cincinnati.
And this was before they joined the MLS. So he wasn't on a huge amount of money. I think he was only just above the minimum payments. So you'd argue that based off his last couple of seasons and the fact that he's been playing reasonably consistently in the first 11, he would probably come to the club and say, well, look, I'm a first 11 player. I should be paid a little bit more. Do we have space in the salary cap for that? Maybe. Who knows? It might just be that additional money we save on Dean Bazanis that we can give to him. But if Griffiths is on a reasonable amount of coin, which I've heard he might be, it might be difficult to keep him on. We may be left with a choice of one of the two of them. Winbickler, disappointing. I think he came on. He would have been a very good player if he didn't get injured. We saw that in his one game that he played. But I'd definitely try to release him if I could and keep both of those two on, because I think Good, Griffiths and Delbridge, irrespective of playing in a, you know, 4-man back line, if we decided to copy the women's setup and play 3 centre-backs and then 2 very attacking wing-backs with guys like Jamo and someone we're about to talk about shortly, it might be a better setup for us as a club, and it'd be good to have all 3 of them there.
I think that when you talk about those two guys, I think with Griffiths, even if he is on reasonable coin, I think Griffiths is in a position where if City do want to keep him and he doesn't sign on with City, I can't see a lot of A-League clubs being keen to pay him a substantial amount and play him constantly anyway. The fact that he's kind of emerged as a potential first or second choice option at centre-half for us could be a career lifeline for him. I really think that you won't have to pay a truckload of money to keep Griffiths around on that basis. Harrison Delbridge, you make a good point. And look, 8 months ago, if Delbridge was out of contract, you probably would have had to pay him a fair amount. Given the performances this season, that's probably pulled that back into line somewhat because he hasn't been great this year. So it'll be interesting to see where those two sit. And again, as we spoke about earlier, how the effects of COVID will sort of change some of those demands of certain players. So I think we're going to go on to Atkinson now then, yeah?
Yep. Yes. Definitely offer a contract.
Keep him
100%. And he's potentially one that will cash in as a product of our youth system in the next couple of years.
I think so.
I reckon we might have trouble retaining him.
Yeah, agreed.
I think there'll be a little bit of coin chucked at him, and reportedly there is from MacArthur.
Will that still happen? Again, though, maybe this whole situation changes that.
Especially as a young player in the environment, do you want to be going from the most stable club in the country to the probably arguably the least stable club in the country? Yeah, a startup. Like it's a very risky move.
He's probably our most improved player this year. I think that all the other clubs will actually have a bit of a dip at him. If for no other reason than to drive his price up with us.
Maybe. To be honest with you, driving his price up probably isn't a big deal because he's still under a youth development deal for us. So I think for another year or two, until he turns 23, I think, and someone can correct me if I'm wrong on this, but his entire wage is separate to the salary cap.
I can't remember the ins and outs of it, but he would surely be almost qualifying for a discount as well soon.
Yeah,
I'm not sure how they qualify that.
So I think what it is that up until a certain age group, you qualify as youth marquee, so you can have your entirety of your wage outside of the salary cap. And then after that point in time, because he's been a development player, you get all the concessions based off time served. So I don't think it's a combination of
both. I'm not sure. I reckon that changed. That youth marquee went out a few years ago, I reckon.
I think you're right, actually.
I think there's still a concession around they might have like base salaries outside the cap, but anything above that, you still have to include, I think.
I'm just looking at it now because I can remember reading something about this. Homegrown players. A club can spend an unlimited amount on 4 Australian players aged 23 or younger that have come through the club's youth system. And this also counts as players who say they've done part of their youth development elsewhere and then we gave them a senior contract. That counts as us.
There it's a complex.
Pay him.
Anyway.
Pay the kid.
To the point, I would keep him.
Sign him up, and then once he reaches 23, we look at selling him overseas.
He might not last that long if he has another season like he's had this year. It may only take one more of those to have interest from overseas. But hey, that's fine, right? That you want to see kids come through the system and head overseas and develop and grow and generate some more income for the club, which can hopefully be pumped back into that youth system. So. Yeah, definitely keep him around. Who else is on the list? Who we got?
Well, speaking of youth players who've come through the system, Denis Jeannot, another who's been rumoured to have
he's gone.
Attacks from MacArthur FC.
Personally, I would keep him, but I reckon he's gone.
Yeah, I'm exactly the same. I think that he is the victim of too many players in front of him in this squad. He needs to be playing. He's a great talent, but I just think we're going to lose him. I'd keep him though, for sure.
I think the second Florin came back, it basically just took out any opportunities that he had, and being sort of there or thereabouts with the Oli Roos for the first half of the season meant that he wasn't getting as much consistent game time as he needed to really kind of bed himself in the squad. And because of that, yeah, I can't see him being our starting number 10 next year. It would be nice if he was, because it would be good to see a youth development player come through and be our creative attacking midfielder. And I think certainly he had the potential to do that, but...
We've essentially got, he's more of a box-to-box midfielder, but we've essentially got that with Connor Metcalf anyway. So, like, it's sad, but that's just the reality of it. And I think if I had to choose between Connor and Denny, I'd keep Connor.
BJT?
Yeah, look, I probably feel that Jeannot's in the overrated category a bit. I'd love to see
spicy.
I'd keep him on a minimum wage kind of deal, but anything more than that. And I think for him personally, he would probably be looking to go elsewhere and get a better crack at things.
Yeah.
Look, happy to have him on minimum wage, but I certainly don't think he's the Jeremy Walker 2.0 that many of the other City fans seem to think he is.
Keep in mind that he does still also come under homegrown players, so his wage is entirely outside of the cap. And the other thing that I consider is that when we're talking about these players and releasing them, is who's the alternative that we're going to get? So who, for the same wage as him, are we going to get of that quality in the league? Who will be a backup centre-back if Florin gets injured again for the entirety of the season? Backup centre-attacking mid if Florin gets injured for a reasonable period of time. And I'm not sure that there are many, particularly... I can't see anyone from our youth team breaking through that's of that quality, except maybe Connor. But
my response to that would be, when has he really been the backup attacking midfielder anyway? Denny Jonro's played, yeah, like, what, something like 5 games for us in the last 2 years?
His game against Western United in Geelong was a very good game.
Yeah, yeah. And look, I would keep him, and I do think he's a good player, but he's not really Florin's backup now. I mean... Connor Metcalf has assumed that role more than Denny. So, whilst I would keep Denny, I think when you're talking about alternatives and squad usage, I don't really think Denny is that considered a factor in this squad at the moment. If we were playing a game tomorrow and Florin Berengay was injured, Denny Jonro wouldn't play.
No, I agree, and I think he was a victim of his own success with the Ollie Roos as well, and missed a lot of kind of the formative parts of the season as the squad was bedding down.
Yes, agreed. And Connor Metcalf had a pretty good period very early on, and I think he's just forced himself more into Eric's plans. And to be honest, I think that given some of the non-use, I reckon Denny's already made up his mind and he's gone. And Eric's just committed to not utilising a young player who's really probably not impressed him that much and isn't going to be here anyway. So, yeah, look, I see what you're saying, but I don't really think that he's that much of a miss to the squad. And personally, I would be looking at the youth team, looking to bring someone in there and fill that backup spot, or what they often seem to do, and this is where we end up with guys like Kamau and Wales, is that they look around the league, see if there's a front third player who's still quite young and hasn't really quite kicked on yet, and bring them in and try to see if they can offer something to the squad before ultimately moving them on in a couple of years.
Well, speaking of moving on, we can do an excellent segue into the next attacking midfielder, which is Florin Berengay.
Ah,
see you later, mate. I hope that the French government expatriates you on a chartered flight. Goodbye. See you later.
Jesus.
Florin has copped it hard.
I'll give you my honest opinion on this guy. He is the biggest victim of the COVID-19 in our squad. He was kind of showing some potential to say maybe give me a new contract. Like, his Derby performance is unbelievable.
Mm.
But... paying him what we're paying him, it just doesn't justify it. Like, he could have kicked on for a third season and maybe taken off, but he's just missed his chance. Unless over the next 3 games, if the season kicks off and he is an absolute world beater, nah, see you later.
See, like, since that Derby, he's probably been consistently in our best 3 to 4 performers each game. As you say, like, COVID has probably had the biggest effect on him of anyone in our squad. But the problem I have with Florin as well is that the number 10 role has been a real weakness for us the last few years. And if you're going to theoretically bring in a new number 10, which I think we have no excuse but to explore, you can't really have a Visa 10 sitting behind a Visa 10. You know, so there's problems with it from a squad construction as well.
The other thing is as well, people say, oh, you know, I'd keep him under the cap. But, like, I don't see him wanting to take a pay cut to stay here.
Mm.
Depends. Quality of life, maybe, you know. I mean, if you're still making like 200K or three, yeah, or however much you'd be making.
He doesn't speak the language. He's on the other side of the world. Like, there's not that much appeal to stay here. Like, I could understand potentially if you're from Melbourne and, you know, you're heading towards the tail end of your career. He's not that old and he's far from home and probably feels a hell of a lot further from home now that all of this kind of COVID stuff's happened. So... you know, where's the incentive for him to take a pay cut?
Get that Australian citizenship and put his kids into the Aussie school system.
It's another three.
I probably think with Florin, I'd offer him a deal under the cap at sub 200k, with the intention that he's our bench midfielder, if you like. You bring in your marquee to replace him in the 10. But I always like having a good option there on the bench that can play through a few of those positions, because you're always going to have injuries. You're always going to have suspensions. I like that you have one quality player sitting on the bench at all times, and I think he's shown enough for me to be that cover if you can get him at the right price.
Angus, tell us how you feel about that.
BT's entitled to his opinion, even if he's wrong.
I don't disagree with BT's logic, but there's just something about putting a visa player on the bench as a locked-in bench option unless someone gets hurt that I just don't like. I'd rather stack the front, the final third, with five visas.
Yeah, I kind of agree. I think we've sort of had this issue a lot of times in the past, which is that we've got a lot of visa options and we'd be like, oh, cool, we're developing Australian youth, but we're spending 2-3 times as much on visa quality players who are just sitting on the bench that just aren't doing anything. And that's part of, I think, what Florin has been. You know, we saw it with Marcin Budzinski. He was probably an okay-ish player for his level, but just never an A-League level. And Florin, yes, he could be good, but he's had 2 years to prove it and he just hasn't done it consistently enough to justify the amount of coin that he's on. And, you know, all he needs to do is get injured again and miss half a season. And then once again, we've wasted, you know, even if it is sub $200,000, it's still wasting sub $200,000 on a player who's not going to do anything and he's not going to solidify that spot. And I'd say, honestly, I'd probably be at the moment paying Adrian Luna Florin's wage, and the other way around, Florin, Adrian Luna's wage. I'm sure he's probably not on very much because Luna has been phenomenal this season in terms of what he's brought to us from an attacking and a defensive perspective. And Florin just hasn't consistently performed enough. So I think, yeah, I can't justify keeping Florin in there when we could look elsewhere.
So I've got a question on the back of that. If Florin Barangay had played 10 all of last season under Warren Joyce's final campaign, would things be different for Florin?
Probably, but I guess you could argue the same to a whole bunch of other things. You know, had Tim Cahill not come out and talk smack about the club after qualifying for the World Cup.
That's Cahill. I'm talking about Florin specifically.
Yeah, yeah. But what I'm saying is we're talking in, you know, theoretical situations.
If we're doing sliding doors moments, do you think he would, if we're talking sliding doors, would he cut his hair short and bleach it blonde to make it easier to tell him apart? Have you seen sliding doors? That's what she does. She gets a hair.
I haven't actually seen the movie.
I watched it last week for the first time. That's why I threw the reference in there.
Gwyneth Paltrow, yeah?
Yeah, yeah, but she does an English accent. It was a real surprise. It was English Gwyneth Paltrow. I actually quite enjoyed it. It was a light-hearted, we've drunk a bottle of wine, let's watch a movie kind of situation. So
Why not?
Don't think much when you're watching it.
I just think that having seen Florin this season, how anyone came to the conclusion that he was a winger is beyond me. Like, he could not be further away from the definition of a wide
player. Well, he did exactly the same thing with Riley McGree. So, like, he's clearly not the most clued in guy.
I will never get it.
This is your under-23s manager, mate. You should fire him based on this conversation alone.
Most people are assistant manager. The manager is Stuart Pearce. Thank you very much.
Assistant to the regional manager.
Most people are angriest about that error for the Bruno Fornaroli thing. The Riley McGree thing makes me so fucking angry, and I will never get over that. That is the worst thing Joyce did, in my opinion. That Riley McGree is such an excellent number 10 at this level, or even a number 8. Probably more of a number 8, actually, to be totally fair. And the fact that that is the way we used him, and Riley McGree could still be at this club potentially if we had have used him correctly, is like absolutely fucking maddening. That really, really annoys me.
See, I have a theory that Warren Joyce's decisions were all made via a magic 8-ball. Like, he just sat there before a game and is just like, where should I play with Riley McGree? Shake, shake, shake. Ask again later. Guess he's on the bench.
Should I play Riley McGree as an 8? Don't bet on it.
Centre back it is.
Any thoughts on that BT before we move on?
Riley McGree.
On anything, but yeah, Riley McGree if you like.
Totally agree, mate. Yeah. That was an absolute disgrace that we played him there. And I kind of get it initially because we had 15,000 midfielders and one winger. But as the season went on, it became clear that we actually had a hole in midfield and we insisted on playing him out there anyway.
You know what the worst thing about that whole winger situation was? Is that we had some wingers. We had Fernando Brandan. We had that Scottish guy.
Lockie Wales.
Well, that's not funny. And, you know, like, they were all gone. They were all gone.
The Scottish bloke just broke down early, didn't he?
Michael, he did, but then he came back and he played 20 minutes and then, like, the next week he was on the plane back to Scotland and they said it was homesickness, but who knows what really happened.
I thought we erred by not playing Richie Delatt there. I think Richie Delatt would have done a banging job on the wing.
Richie Delatt was a right winger at this level of football. 100%. He was just too good a footballer.
Or just could have just rolled the dice and put Atkins in there as well. Like, Atkins is a decent winger.
Yeah, you're right.
Like, anyway.
Yeah, the more I think about this, the angrier I get. Who's the next on our list of
Well, speaking of keeping Matty Benici angry, Lachlan Wales is up next. Thank God we don't have Rennie on this podcast.
I tell you what, I tried so hard to, like, you know, give Lachlan Wales every chance possible, but I'm sorry, Rennie, if you're listening, and I'm sorry, Lachlan Wales, if this... Mate, he's hopeless. He's just not good. Seems like seems like a real good kid, you know, and that's nice, you know. He seems like a really.
I'll talk to you about that offline, Matty. But if the flights to the Central Coast aren't running from Melbourne, I will drive down from Sydney to Melbourne and drive him back up to the Central Coast myself.
Who's the worst footballer?
Later.
Who's the worst footballer, Kamau or Lockie Wales?
Lockie Wales, hands down. Kamau had moments of brilliance.
Wales works a lot harder though. He's just got no end product.
Wales works hard and he's an outstanding athlete. But the problem is that he's not a fantastic footballer.
I totally get why coaches love him.
Mm.
He works and works and works. He does all the right things. But then when he has to put a pass or a cross or a finish in the box, he just turns into, I don't know.
He did pull off an assist on what was my favourite game of the season though, so... Are we doing favourite games of the season?
We'll do that a bit later.
Okay, good.
Let it go. But, I agree with you because I can totally understand. Like, as a coach, if you see a young guy putting in the work, you err on the side of, well, you know, skills, you can build on skills. You can increase confidence. You can do these other things. If he's going to run around and put in the hard work and get stuck in, that's what you want to see as a coach. But unfortunately for Wales, he just hasn't shown – he hasn't come on in any way in terms of his composure or his end product, you know.
I think he's barely NPL quality.
Look, I mean, based on his athleticism, you know, some of the players we've seen get into the A-League, I mean, if Elvis is a good NPL player, you know, then Wales, just by running in straight lines, must be able to do half decent as well. So he would probably do quite well at NPL level, but I don't think he's ever going to be an A-League level player. Unless something changes drastically.
I suspect he'll go back to Central Coast and play there.
They have a lot of NPL level players, so probably.
Yeah, and I think at Central Coast, he'll probably do okay because he'll... Probably the difficult thing for him has been the expectation of being at a club like City where, you know,
Where we actually pay our players to play football.
Correct, yeah. But also the expectation is that he'll come in and it won't just be that he'll do a job. You know, there's a lot of people on Twitter and social media and stuff like that are pretty aggressive. I mean, we've seen how much hate Dean Bazanis gets, and Lockie Wales is probably the other scapegoat for the club at the moment. I suspect he'll go back to Central Coast where they'll love him just because he's a coastie, and because of that, he'll start getting his confidence back and doing okay. Like, he might get, you know, 5 or 6 goals a season, but I can't see him ever being a... you know, world-beating top league player. I think he'll be a...
Has he hit the target 5 times for us in his entire career?
I'm going to say 3.
I'm not talking goals. I'm not talking goals. I'm talking shots on target.
I'm going to say 3 still.
I think Matty is right. 6 goals a season.
5 or 6 goals a season is really, really selling that high, dude. I don't think he's going to be that sort of player ever.
No. BT, what do you reckon?
Yeah, move him on. See you, mate.
Let's go. Next option. See you, Lockie.
So that's all of the off-contract players for us. There's 2 youth players who are off-contract, Joe Gauci and Bernardo Oliveiro, but we don't really know enough about them to say anything one way or the other. And
Joe Gauci's a keeper, yeah?
One more, Lockie.
Who's that?
Mr. Markel Susieta.
Ah, that's true.
This is going to be a good conversation. Because the person who is second most affected by COVID in this squad, Angus, is Markel Susieta. Because he was starting to come onto form a little bit.
Because if he gets sent home,
what was that?
Because if he gets sent home, he'll get it.
Jesus.
No, I'd definitely keep him. Under the basically, cap. I'd keep him whenever he's getting paid at the moment. I'd keep him. You'd almost have a case for Marquee with him. I'd keep him for two reasons. One, he's got absolute pedigree. The guy has a history to back him, which Florin doesn't. And two, I saw enough out of him to say, hey, this guy's been rusty because he hasn't played football really for the last 18 months preceding this, but there's a hell of a lot of talent there. Yeah, no, he's definitely one to keep.
I mean, you've got to be a certain level of quality to be the captain of Athletic Bilbao.
Yeah, I mean, he's in his last three or four games before the shutdown were pretty good. He was starting to find the target. You could see that, you know, we spoke about that on a previous podcast, but, you know, a player of that quality, it's often as much about stepping down as anything else, adjusting to the fact that you're playing with lower quality teammates. You're not going to hit the same sort of passes you were hitting in a league like La Liga, and you're not going to get delivered those sorts of passes as well. You know, you need to kind of adjust. And I feel like in those last three or four games, he looked like he was getting into the rhythm of how we were playing. He found the target a couple of times. That little ghost run against, was it Central Coast or Newcastle or whatever, where he just sort of ghosted into the far post. You know, just the intelligence of the player. He's such a smart footballer. And I think if we can get a proper number 10 between him and a really dynamic inside forward on the other side of the pitch, that's going to free up a guy like him to create chaos, I think.
And as well as that, when you consider the fact that what he's going to bring to the squad is that creativity for guys like Jamie McLaren to put hatfuls of goals away. I think based on his pedigree alone, yes, absolutely, we have to keep him. It's just going to be that
one of the byproducts of him coming in as well is actually since he's come in, Noon, in my opinion, has been a bit better.
Yeah, I think that's
fair. People haven't been able to focus on Noon exclusively as they have been up until this point. So having the two decent wingers has been good for us.
For me, and as well as that, we've taken... Oh, sorry, you go.
Yeah, I'd have him under the cap. And that might be on a very healthy wage. It could be a 400K. But I don't think he's worth the marquee slot. Purely because we've sort of just... As Matty kind of just said, on the caveat that we get a good number 10 in that he can work with, it'll make such a difference. I think we need that marquee spot for that 10.
Yeah.
He's not enough of a game breaker, if you like, to be holding that marquee spot in my opinion. I think we need someone like a Castro to take that second marquee slot.
Yeah.
And then if we can get Markel in on good wages out on the other wing, happy days.
You could even do him on a back-ended contract.
Oh, I don't want to do that anymore.
No.
Yeah, that backfired with Florin.
I think one thing that we probably already knew this, but one thing that we've really found out in the last few years is you cannot get a really, really, really good A-League quality 10 without spending a marquee spot on it. You just can't do it. They don't exist. Players that are able to open games the way that those kind of guys are in that area of the pitch are going to cost a truckload of cash. So if you want a really good 10, you've got to use that marquee spot on it. Look at guys like Castro, Ninkovic. You know, those quality guys aren't going to come under the cap. You know, Mezhajetsky, whatever the hell, when he was still here, you know.
Mezhajetsky.
Yeah. I used to call him the old Jetski. But, yeah, you're not going to get those quality of guys under the cap. So, yeah, I would be looking to, as BT said, give him a healthy wage under the cap. And with, you know, with Florin potentially departing, that probably opens that opportunity somewhat. So, yeah, we'll see how that goes. So I think that's it then. We've cleared up the entire squad. And to a degree, we've really discussed what we would do next year, I think, which is primarily find a good number 10. And I think maybe potentially a central midfield partner for Brillante would be a priority for me as well.
I'm happy with Luna there, to be honest.
Yeah, for sure.
I'm sort of counting Luna as maybe one of my front three options. You know, how that affects maybe in a situation where you bring in a really good number 10, Craig Nunez forced to the bench.
Yeah, and that's fine. Yep.
I reckon Luna's probably better from the mid than he is out wide, because I don't see him as having that kind of creative, incisive run. I see him more of doing that kind of destructive blocking, kind of your high press from the midfield type thing. You've sort of seen him later on in the season having Jamie McLaren here and Luna just doing the ones where he's running in behind and putting the pressure on the goalkeeper. I think Brillante, Luna and a new number 10, Suceda on the right, Noon on the left, and J-Mac up front is a hell of an attacking lineup.
Fair.
Yeah. Shall we go to a bit of a break and then come back and have a bit more of a chat about the league in general?
Yeah, sure. Why not?
You're listening to Talking City.
Thank you very much, everybody. Just a quick lunch break there while Angus made himself some easy Mac. And we had
a long black.
And we had a bit of a change of background. Rennie, if you're watching, I hope you're feeling a lot better now that you see the great man up behind me.
I'm just waiting on someone from his crew giving you a call and being like, you need to take that down.
I like how the boyfriend is looking at you, Lockie.
Yeah, that's a sensational aspect of that background.
Look, I don't judge what people see as love.
Yeah, I get it, man. Like, I definitely relate, and I see where he's coming from.
As the only member of the Lockamite fan club, apparently. That was a great call.
So the purpose of this segment. Oh no, you go, Lockie, because you probably know more about this anyway than me. So
I was going to say, like, the only thing that I think we had left over to talk about was. Thank you. Got that one. The only thing we had left to talk about was the fact that potentially at the start of next season, there might be a new broadcaster, depending on what happens with this Fox Sports legal deal. And it'd be good to hear Angus's perspective on this. But the rumors coming out is, well, certainly we know that Fox Sports hasn't paid the final quarter payment, which is $12 million to the club, which is one of the main reasons why a lot of the clubs are putting players on Job Seeker, because they just simply don't have the cash to pay them the remainder of their contract for the season. We know that the deal is worth $57 million a season. And if the season's not completed, there's rumours that if it's not completed by the end of June, then we'll be considered in breach of contract and Fox Sports has the right to cancel the contract from there, which is a reasonable amount of money lost per year. And we know that Fox...
It sounds like Fox are already in breach without paying. So
that's one of the things. What I've read is...
I've not been following this very closely.
It's so confusing. On the surface, it's so confusing. Like,
my understanding of what it is that both Fox and the FFA will be in breach of contract. So Fox already, by not paying them, are in breach of contract. But what they're trying to do is force the contract to be breached so it can be null and void, so they don't have to pay the $57 million. They're just trying to find a way to get rid of the A-League from their books, because for them it's not considered worth the money, and they've been trying to cut back on different live sports for things that just aren't getting in the views that they would previously. So what they're trying to do is get to the end of the season without the season being played so they can get rid of it.
So the contract would in essence be voided before anyone can take legal action for them breaching it?
Correct, yeah. So if the FFA puts in a legal stoush against Fox Sports saying you didn't pay the $12 million, then Fox Sports basically just gets to the end of June and just goes, you guys have breached your contract and you haven't given us any video or any content, therefore we're null and voiding the contract. So it's interesting. I guess the big rumor to come out of it is that Optus Sports are going to look at trying to buy out the A-League license, which would be good. It would mean EPL and A-League back on the same channel, so you'd only need to have one subscription. But I couldn't imagine that they're going to be paying $57 million in the current climate for the A-League.
Content will probably be better.
That's one thing.
I got to say, for Optus Sport, man, they have put out some seriously good content during this break.
No, they have. And I wasn't keen on Optus Sport at the start. Like, it's become easier for me because now that I have the app through the Xbox One, like, it makes it a lot simpler. I would like it if they had some kind of streaming service that was a lot easier to use on smart TV. I know you can do it without too much difficulty, but I'm a bit of a fucking idiot when it comes to stuff like that. So, but content wise, they have been really good. They hit Fox Sports for six, to be totally honest. And their presenters as well, when they're actually doing Optus specific stuff, are really good. And obviously, from a Premier League standpoint, they've been running through all that match of the day stuff as well. So,
pundits and Archie Thompson.
Oh my God. Honestly.
None of their pundits have two-footed a child.
Well, that's the greatest thing Archie's ever done, in all fairness.
It's one of those things that, like, Optus doesn't seem to have the same boys' club mentality that the Foxtel guys have.
Yeah, yeah. To be fair, though, if it did move over, you'd probably see a lot of those guys get employment with Optus.
Oh, no doubt. Garby's probably already having conversations with them already, but like...
But I mean, even your Robbie Slaters and your Archie Thompsons.
Yeah, yeah, yeah. And your Bosniches. I don't think Archie Thompson would make it across. I think Optus is far more of a professional operation. So I'd just be interested to see what kind of content they can kind of put out. And I like that, yeah, okay, KO deals with the on-demand stuff now a bit better than Foxtel did. But the Optus shows, their on-demand features and the functionality is just light years ahead of what Foxtel's doing with the A-League anyway. So
even, you know, like your mini matches and stuff like that. Like I love...
Mini matches are good.
I love KO that stuff. That, doesn't it? KO does for some of the sports, not all of them. But yeah, it's... Well, KO has been... Like I've been on KO Sport for like a year now, and yeah, I don't regret it at all. I reckon it's absolutely sensational. But yeah, the mini match stuff, like just the ability to like... before the shutdown, like if you're going down to gym or something and you just chuck on a match from the weekend, a couple of mini matches or something, it just, you know, it's a lot easier to ingest a few of the games that you missed.
Yeah.
You know, like, or a neutral game that you don't necessarily want to watch a whole game.
Yeah. And the highlight packages as well, just having like the goals, like overnight goals wrapped up as well. So I'd like what I used to do, what I really liked about, and yeah, you can do this on KO and whatnot, but what I liked is that I could wake up on a Sunday morning, watch the Chelsea game just on demand without having seen the score, without seeing anything else, watch that game and then go and watch the other goals from the other games, which has been really good. And yeah, KO's functionality is just not the same user experience as what Optus is providing though. So
yeah. And I think, you know, to be honest, I think Foxtel are probably in a position where they need to be a bit careful about how they're managing a lot of this stuff, because if they're losing the majority of their sporting offerings, it's going to do significant damage, you would think. I mean, you lose the EPL, you lose the A-League. From a sporting standpoint, your only league that you'd be offering in completion is what? Like AFL and NRL. They don't offer any overseas sports in a completed form. I mean, like,
AFL and NFL, both of them, you get, if you've got a Telstra mobile phone, you get them for free.
Yeah. Well, that too. And I mean, in terms of overseas sports, like as someone that follows basketball and stuff, they show like 3 games a week. So why would I want to use Foxtel for that anyway? You know, so yeah, it's only AFL and NRL. And as you said, if you get a Telstra mobile, you can stream that, you know. So, looking up.
Yeah, it's an interesting business strategy. Super Rugby is another one that they're probably looking to offload as well. Like all the money in rugby is in the internationals anyway, but I don't know, man. Like you say, do you just want to be cricket, rugby, and AFL, like rugby league and AFL, if that's what they want? I just think that they're losing out on a lot of kind of the ability to control the niche sports. So
yeah, and in the modern era where so many people are willing to go and get their streaming, you know, have their streaming separately because you know you've got your Netflix, you've got your Disney Plus, you've got your KO, you've got your Optus Sport. It's not an inconvenience anymore. You know, maybe a couple of years ago, people were like, oh, I can't be asked. I'll just have Foxtel. All I'm missing is the Premier League. Now, have it all separately. What difference does it make?
Yeah. Yeah. And then, like, you got the NBA League Pass and those kind of things. So,
exactly.
You know, there's not really that much incentive to stay with it.
I think Foxtel's not so much any one specific thing, but they're starting to become a death by a thousand cuts scenario.
Yes.
Mm. Yeah, and you would have thought that KO kind of addressed that, but when you're losing sports left, right, and centre on KO, like, what incentive is there to have it?
Yeah, no, that's right. So yeah, look,
I mean, to be fair, if the Murdoch empire all dies because of COVID, I won't be sad.
Oh, here we go.
Comrade Lachlan. Is that a hammer and sickle I see in the background?
It might
be. That's why he's got the background on. He's maybe doesn't want to seeing his Soviet flag.
Maybe we should just get the ABC to run all the sport for us, huh?
That would be, if I can't remember the name of that guy, Aaron Cheng or someone, who did the sideline commentary. That was atrocious.
That was intentional. The ABC's, he's a comedian, that guy.
He is that was very funny. I don't know. You got to be funny to be a comedian. Right.
It would go on some stand up bit about the Chinese granny on the plane. It's a
well, I think that's probably a good enough segue into myths and moments, as any.
I guess it is.
Do you want to do the mosquito, or should I add it in post?
You can add it in post. We've got the mosquito behind me. Oh well, the slam didn't work on my desk. You slammed the desk.
Oh, my desk is not a slammable one.
I'll add something in over the top of that in post. It'll look good.
Boom. Myths and moments.
It was a nuclear explosion.
All right. So speaking of
nuclear, I want some hot off the press here.
Go.
This is a myths and moments. I don't know if this is onside or offside. I don't know if you should celebrate things like this, but here's just a breaking one for you. Everyone is reporting that Kim Jong-un died now.
I've heard that.
Would we be significantly...
Like within the time that we've been recording this podcast, everyone's been starting to report. I've been getting notifications popping up.
Are we are we sure?
My onside / offside from this is the onside of how attractive his sister, who will be the new leader, is.
Kim Jong-il.
I think you guys are overselling her. Sister? I mean, she's okay.
No, she's not bad.
She's hot, man.
I know you like you were saying, you got the power factor, right? Which is a totally valid argument, you know, powerful women, so on and so forth. But she's okay.
Nah, she's just straight up hot, man. I'll send you a meme.
I'll send you a meme. That'll fix everything. So, live on the Talking City podcast, we can confirm the death of...
Oh, I don't know if we can confirm. All I can confirm is that his...
I don't know. If TMZ's confirming it without any confirmation, I think we can confirm whatever that
TMZ
was.
TMZ gets on to everybody's deaths first.
Yeah. TMZ this is a shattering blow.
The way that TMZ reports it, though, is so fucking funny. Like, I read there, because DJ Academics posted it on Instagram, and they're like... Oh, I will have to read this out because this shit's so fucking funny. Like, the way they do it is just not like normal news.
Absolutely. I mean, while you're bringing that up, 36-year-old dying after heart surgery. I mean, lifestyle choice mistakes were made.
36-year-old?
Yeah. That's how old he is. He's 36. He's 4 years older than me.
Bullshit.
Yeah.
He looks like he's 50.
Yeah.
Wow.
I think probably the best meme to come out of it is that one. You guys have seen that episode of The Office where there's the Japanese heart surgeon who works in Daryl's warehouse, and he talks about how he was a heart surgeon in Japan operating on Yakuza. Big mistake. Yakuza boss die. I get on a boat and I hide away. I come to America. Daryl takes me in. My big secret, I'm actually a really good surgeon. Very steady hand. I kill Yakuza boss on purpose. The repurposing of that for Kim Jong-un has been hilarious.
Oh, man. I tell you, no wonder nobody's got any food over there, because that guy must be eating all of it then. If that's the way he looks at 36, Jesus.
All right, so here's the paragraph from the TMZ article. Amid reports, China has sent a medical team to their communist neighbors this week to check in / advise on Kim. A Hong Kong-backed news channel's vice director, who's apparently the niece of a Chinese foreign minister, blasted out the news herself, .. He's dead. Oh, man. Just the way they type their news. Sometimes just reading some of their news articles is so funny. Their coverage of the whole 6ix9ine situation was so good.
I saw a good tweet saying that they get onto these public, these celebrity deaths so quickly that they're probably causing like a substantial amount of them just for the news.
Have you seen Chris D'Elia's latest stand-up special? He does a really good impersonation of the TMZ guys. He's like, they're always at the airport and they're like, hey, Chris D'Elia, you got an opinion on this? Anyway, it's worth checking out.
So speaking of Netflix, shall we have a bit of a chat about Carole Baskin?
Onside Tiger King.
Yeah, Tiger King was good. I really like Tiger King. Because what Tiger King taught me, so I always knew the fact that there's more tigers in captivity in America than there is in the wild.
And I always thought to myself, man, it's like heaps of people with Tigers. And now I realize, nah, it's like five people with heaps of Tigers.
Well, man, they were saying on that show, didn't they, at some point, they said like a Tiger Cub costs like 3K? That's nothing.
No, it's like the same price as a dog.
Yeah, like that is like a pure pedigree dog price.
Yeah, we used to have a show dog when I was a kid, and he cost more than that.
I'm surprised that everybody, I mean, like, aside from the...
I'm sure what Matty's saying is critically important, but it's also...
Obviously, some of them don't care.
Carol's...
Matty, we've lost you there. But anyway,
Let me see if I...
Can we get a show of hands on who thinks that Carole Baskin killed her husband?
There we go.
I did like that other rumor that Carole Baskin's original husband was the...
Good thing I'm not wearing the polo.
Was, what's his name? Jeff Lowe.
Jeff Rowe. Jeff Lowe, yeah. He does look like him. Nah, Jeff Lowe's way too much of a scumbag to be Carol's ex-husband. Yeah. Like, just that Jeff Lowe... Every story about Jeff Lowe, man, like when he goes back to Vegas and gets like in trouble with the law and all that kind of stuff, like the dude is just like clearly a scumbag, but good on it. Like, he's
Very curious what the hell they're going to do about a second season, because like it's the same as Making a Murderer. It just went crazy to the point where they had to do something more about it. But season two of Making a Murderer was just it didn't add anything. I don't know.
I don't think they'll do anything. I don't think they'll do anything additional with Tiger King. I think that's it. They've got their lightning in a bottle. It's like, don't fuck with cats. Like, the story's over. Mm. So.
No, man.
Watched another good one recently. What was that called? It was like Criminal Genius or something. Give me a sec. I'll look it up. It was on Netflix. Anyway, it's like a four-part crime series about like a bank heist. It's bloody fantastic.
Oh, is that the one where the bomb around the guy's neck?
Bomb around the guy's neck.
Yeah, I watched that a couple of years ago. That thing is brilliant. It's another one of those ones Evil where Genius. It's too crazy to... Too crazy to believe. Like, you're like,
yeah, Evil Genius, it was called. I really like that one.
Yeah.
Yeah. Netflix has got some real good quality at the moment. I've been watching a lot of Stan as well. So I've been working through The Office. So I'm almost finished season 5.
I prefer the British one.
Yeah. Personally. British one's only got 12 episodes.
Yeah. That's kind of why I like it, though.
Yeah. Well, the British one... Oh, actually, here's a really good onside, and this is kind of on theme. The English Game. Have you checked that out yet?
No.
Dude, me and Ash have watched it all. It's so good because it's about football, but it's also like real Pride and Prejudice-y. So it's like got the perfect balance for like the chicks and the guys. So it's a story about like the early FA Cup and the first professional players. And then like the conflict between like the upper classes who had dominated the FA Cup up until that point and the working class teams. Anyway, awesome series. Only 6 episodes. Really enjoyed it.
Okay. Interesting.
So, onside is the English Game.
Yes. Okay, onside, English Game. As we discussed earlier, onside Football Manager.
Yeah, Football Manager. I've lost a lot of hours to that.
I've lost a lot of my life to Football Manager.
Yes.
I've been playing since like Football Manager 07 or 08.
Yeah, I would have started around then in time. I stopped for a few years, to be honest. I stopped at about 13 or 14, and now I've just started playing again because I'm sitting at home doing nothing today.
I have self-imposed, time off from it, so I'll play pretty a lot for, a couple of months, and then I have to stay off it for a few months. Otherwise,
I never really got into it all that much. I think it was just... Once you sort of open it up and you're like, here's every option straight away... Here's the rest of your life panned out for you. And it's like, maybe not. I think it'll be too much of a deep dive.
I like people.
Well, I like people too, but I can't see people at the moment. So when I finish working every day, I've got a self-imposed no working past 5 o'clock while I'm working from home. So Manager is something to look forward to.
Yes.
Oh man, my partner, my fiance is just working some ridiculous hours. And so I'm like, nah, that's not me. I just got to I start at 7:30 in the morning, 5 o'clock, boom, I'm done. I'm not doing the 8 o'clock to 8 o'clock like she is.
Nah, fuck that.
Not for me. Anyway, so Football Manager gives me a reason to stop working.
It's probably fair. I've been playing a bit of Final Fantasy VII Remake.
Is it good?
It's really good. So like the system is very different to the original Final Fantasy, and it only takes up that period of Midgar, which in the original game was like 5 hours, maybe. Like you could have that section done pretty quickly, but they pad it out, and getting through that period took me about 55 hours after work or so. And it just, the depth to it is so much better. Like if you ever watched Final Fantasy VII Advent Children, I think it was a movie that they released in 2005, which was just unreal quality. It's sort of similar to that. It adds a whole bunch in. The combat's interesting. It's a combination of action and still using a little bit of the active time battle side of things. Summons are nowhere near as good as they were in the original game, but it's fun. And the story itself is good. It changes things. I won't go into too much detail because there's a lot of spoilers in there, but there are parts of the story that are expanded, parts that are similar but different. It's definitely worthwhile playing if you're a Final Fantasy game, and I'm very curious to see how long it's going to be before the next section of it comes out, because yeah, there's a lot left to go in the Final Fantasy story, and I'm very interested to see where they go with it.
No, I personally never played 7. I mean, I was really into the old sprite ones. So like, you know, Final Fantasy 6, which I think might have been 3 in the US or something. I can't remember. There's a bit of
Final Fantasy 6.
Like Final Fantasy 6 and like, yeah, Chrono Trigger and stuff like that. I loved all like the sprite JRPGs when I was a kid. That was probably sort of my last interaction with them. But if there's a discount on 7 at some point, I'll probably jump in and grab it, because I've heard some pretty good things. So, yeah, okay.
It's definitely worth it. And like the... yeah, the story itself, the way that it's told, the voice acting, the characters, yeah, it's just done really well. It's a massive nostalgia trip with a lot of, you know, modern changes to it. So it's a good, fun one. It's definitely worthwhile picking up.
All right.
It just makes me want to force them to do Final Fantasy IX as well, because that was the best PlayStation Final Fantasy by a mile.
BT.
No arguments there.
Are they playing anything other than cars, tea parties, and peekaboo?
Which one's onside? Which one's offside?
Probably cars, because when she gets frustrated, she throws them and hits the 6-month-old in the head with them.
Sounds reasonable.
That's pretty funny. Are they like Hot Wheels?
Yeah.
The old Hot Wheels? Oh, yeah, Hot Wheels.
Yeah.
Remember they used to make like the little cars for the AFL? Do they still do that shit anymore? We used to get like the little car with the team stuff painted on it.
Ours are mostly police cars and Lamborghinis, but we've only got a dozen at the minute.
Good spender.
It's enough for a 2-year-old.
Hi, Ash.
Hey, I'll say hi.
Hello.
Hi.
You're still recording?
Yeah.
we're recording. Live.
It's going to be on YouTube.
Do you want to come and talk about what Netflix shows you like?
No.
She said no.
That's probably reasonable.
Yeah, that's fair. That's fair.
All right.
Well, this, like, this is probably about a time to wrap it up, isn't it?
This has gone long enough. Yeah. This has gone way longer than it had any right to. Let's be honest.
No. And if anyone's listened all this way through, good work.
God bless you all.
Well, I mean, Angus is here recording it, so it won't be him listening through to the end now. So we know that's one listener down.
Yeah, it's true. No, I normally just play them like on repeat on my podcast player to pump up the listens and views and whatnot.
Smart. Set it to repeat and go to sleep. There's another 8 years.
Yeah. 12 hours worth.
Well, I guess we may look at trying to do another one of these video podcasts, recording at some point in time in the future.
As it's required.
When the season kicks off again, mate. When
exactly. If there's anything that you guys listening want us to talk about or do differently next time, just send us a message on Facebook, Twitter, Instagram, Discord, YouTube, LinkedIn, YouTube comment section, Twitch.
Yeah, so this is going to be a dual,
etc.
This is going to be dual, right? It's going to be audio podcast and visual through YouTube. So
correct, yeah. So we're going to release this through YouTube and also through the standard podcasting network. So if there's anything that you want us to have a chat about next time, just sing out, let us know, and we'll look into it.
All right.
Adios.
Stay safe. Take care. See you later.
Thanks for listening to Talking City. Make sure to subscribe via iTunes, Spotify, and the Google podcasting app.